Kent, thank you so much for willing to do this and to share your time and your knowledge. Your new book, Biology of the Brain and How Your Gut Microbiome Affects Your Brain, is timely, especially these days with all the stress eating and mental health impact of COVID-19. So Kent, for those of you who don't know him, is a recognized expert in women's health issues and orthonutrition. Orthomolecular medicine is the form of alternative medicine that aims to maintain human health through nutritional supplementation. Such a big offshoot from being a pharmacist, and it's so refreshing. So he's the founder and CEO of NutriChem Compounding Pharmacy, a clinic here in Ottawa, Ontario. And as a pharmacist for over 35 years, Kent, you've certainly seen the damage that's been caused by the attitude of just take a pill and you'll feel better. My clients search me out because they don't want to just take a pill or an injection to treat their osteoporosis. They're looking for smarter, safer ways. They want their skeleton to support them without having to worry about the side effect of pharmaceuticals to building stronger bone. So this whole field of microbiome and bone health has evolved and has its own name, the osteomicrobiome. And in reading your book, I've come to realize that without a healthy microbiome, it's hard for people to do the things I'm wanting them to do, which is to have the energy to be active and to exercise. And it's also hard for them to assimilate the nutrients they need to build better bones. And lastly, I would love for you to also address the impact that our microbiome has on our hormones. So with that, I would love to get started and give the table over to you, but what I would, if you don't mind covering something really basic first, is just, you know, what is the microbiome and where is it in our body? And if you want to cover that one first, that'd be great.
So the microbiome is essentially microbes or the bugs that live on and inside our body. So they're, you know, we have bugs in our nose and our skin and vagina, but mainly most of our volume of our microbiomes is found in our gastrointestinal system, essentially our poop. So we have trillions and trillions of these bugs, over 100 trillion, which you know, maybe about even in our, it has a mass of about, on the average human, about 4 or 5 pounds. And there's more genetic material, almost 10 times more genetic material in our microbiomes and these bugs and are in our whole human body. And eventually, we're some of the literature, there's just so much research now, tens of thousands of studies per month, that we're beginning to think that perhaps we were evolved around our bugs. You know, the bugs aren't just a side effect for us. You know what I mean? They're so profoundly interconnected to our body that perhaps, you know, we were, our whole cellular system evolved around the genetic, and our bodies developed around the genetics of the microbiome. So it's quite fascinating.
So it is fascinating. So how does the microbiome impact the absorption of nutrients?
So the absorption of nutrients, there's just one cell layer, really one lining cell that just between our gut, our poop, and our human, and our body, just one cell. And that absorptive cell layer is intimately dependent on the energy that comes from your microbiome. It is essential. In fact, you know, I did years of 35 years ago, I did a whole paper on iron absorption, and I thought I knew everything about iron and the forms of iron, and this iron molecule is the best one for absorption. I designed iron supplements. Today, if I have resistant iron levels where a woman can't get her iron levels up, I know it's a microbiome problem, not a problem with the kind of iron I'm giving. It's quite a difference. Do you see that? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So she would go, well, I'm just, or women are told, and I use iron because we test it more than, you know, it's a lot of other nutrients, right? Well, you know, we don't test every other nutrient, but so iron is clear. But iron, low iron levels is generally a symptom, for example, of a poor microbiome. That's quite a statement, but that's true. So that's, if that's the one you see, what about everything else? So the mechanisms, you know, you can go on and on about all the different ways that microbiome influences nutrient absorption. It's not just iron, it's every nutrient.
Very interesting. Now, you have, you know, had some case studies in your book, and, you know, in my field, you know, we're trying to get people to move more. And you mentioned how when you start to make someone's micro or encourage someone to make changes to their life to improve their own microbiome, that their energy level improves. So is this, you know, and then they just start to want to move and start to exercise. And is this simply because they're now absorbing the nutrients that our bodies need to?
Well, there's multiple reasons why. That's one obvious, you know, the obvious one is you're getting more nutrients. Another not so obvious is that link between the liver and the microbiome and detoxification. So many people, we have an epidemic of, for example, of non-alcoholic fatty liver. So our livers are being overwhelmed because our microbiomes are not functioning optimally. In fact, a recent literature, we have basically proof, for example, that elevated cholesterol levels may be a function of a poor microbiome. So the microbiome, so cholesterol homeostasis, meaning it's how it works, is dependent on the microbiome. So we give all these drugs for cholesterol, but really what it's telling us is that our microbiomes aren't healthy. And when your microbiome is healthy, all your energy and you get is put in detoxification. It also even gets into the cellular level, because your mitochondria, the pistons of your body, they will function at all costs. But if they are not, if the oxidative stress is enhanced, they will pull energy from elsewhere in the body to maintain. It's like your car engine must function, and it will sacrifice, you know, your car radio, the tires, the you know, all these other systems. So there's multiple ways that the microbiome is influencing energy. And fascinatingly, when you bring up energy, the number one reason in, for example, in Ontario, that actual people go to physicians, the number one reason people aren't aware is actually low energy.
Wow.
So it's, and if you think about it, once, you know, medically we've looked at, oh, your iron is good. That's why I bring up iron. You know, your thyroid's fine. Well, I don't know. You're just getting old, right? So it's an intense connection to the microbiome at multiple levels.
Very fascinating. Do you mind if I finish the loop, you know, at least on a, I'm going to say basic level, when we're thinking bone health, you know, we're thinking, you know, exercise with the energy to move, and then nutrition. And then the last, you know, leg of that tripod, you know, to get the perfect picture of health and strong bones tends to be hormones. And so do you mind touching upon how the microbiome and our hormones and how that relationship?
Yeah, of course. Again, you know, just to reemphasize, exercise improves your microbiome. And we see this back and forth effect of how lifestyle, like exercise, improves your microbiome. So again, it's quite fascinating, right? That exercise, things that are essential for human life, are so obviously improving each other. But things like hormones, again, are fascinating, because we have an epidemic of hormone problems in humans. What does that mean? It means we have an epidemic of infertility. We have an epidemic of premenstrual problems, an epidemic of endometriosis. We have a, breast cancer increasing. We have polycystic ovarian syndrome increasing dramatically. So we have all these hormonal-based issues increasing significantly. So in our clinic, we treat all these, but guess what we treat first? We treat the microbiome, and we see significant improvements to all of these. And why? Because the microbiome is intimately involved in hormone metabolism. So when your microbiome is unhealthy, you will recycle estrogens. So your estrogen levels will go higher and higher, and you will trend to make unhealthier estrogens. So those are in women who are menstruating, women who are still creating their own hormones. So understanding the microbiome and that imbalance, and that may actually be impacting bone density as well. So your actual ability to lay bone, because you're creating imbalances in the hormonal structure that can affect bone. So there's intimate, so today, compared to years ago, we won't give hormones to a woman yet until we are confident that the woman has a healthy microbiome. And so many women come to us for hormonal issues, wanting hormones, and often after we improve their microbiome, they go, well, I don't have any hormonal issues anymore. Do you know? And I go, well, but you know, you still may need some hormones to maintain your bone, right? So but it's quite fascinating how our symptoms of hormonal issues are in. So we see significant, improvements to fertility. Ironically, in my company, we make all the hormones that a doctor is traditionally give for infertility. But on the other clinic, we have other side, we have clinicians that improve fertility with microbiome and dietary interventions. And guess which ones work better. Yeah, you got it. The microbiome stuff. Right in my own facility, we see the two worlds, and often never the twain shall meet for some reason.
Wow, very exciting. Can I ask, because years ago, we had a discussion about vitamin D, and we know that vitamin D is actually in the hormone families as opposed to the vitamin families. And you had said to me how, you could have somebody on, or not that you put them on, but sometimes they're on 10,000 international units a day, and they're still not absorbing their vitamin D, or their serum levels are not coming into a sufficient level. Are you finding that by improving their microbiome, that you're able to also impact their serum vitamin D levels, for instance?
There's a lot, without going down the vitamin D rabbit hole, but there is a lot of other chemistries, including the microbiome, in vitamin D status. But there are other factors as well, liver factors in it, that we mentioned, that of the liver symptoms, which may be so secondary to the microbiome, our liver,
kidneys.
So there's others. We're starting to see where the microbiome is indirectly affecting, these mysteries of what's going on. So yes, it is the microbiome kind of there indirectly. But yeah, good question.
And then only because of my exercise background and passion, you mentioned how exercise improves the microbiome.
Correct.
And we know, there's specific exercise like high intensity interval training that will stimulate the mitochondria. Do you know if there's a specific type of exercise that helps the microbiome?
That's a great question. I just, as a non-exercise specialist, I just said, click, there it is. Exercise helps the microbiome. Proof, we knew. There it is, move on, But yes, as an exercise specialist, it would be relevant. One of the things that I am observing, that is interesting is that intensity may not be it's a signal, right? It's a signal as opposed to a intensity. So we're seeing that more. So a signal of motion and exercise is crucial, as and maybe as not as much as intensity. So that's what I'm seeing in my overview of it without getting in it, which kind of makes sense. You know, in one way we know when, you know, pounding and intensity works for bone, but the very signal of exercise changes anabolic drive and microbiome. So that's interesting as well.
Yeah, it's like when we're looking at the studies on sitting, you know, and how you can go for a 30-minute run, but if you then sit for the next 18 hours of the day, you know,
that's right. You're changing the signal, aren't you? Right. That's going to my point.
Yeah. Yes. So okay. That in animal studies, that frequent, you know, small signals are so much better for our bones. So just getting up, walking around the house, right. You know,
absolutely.
It's, yeah. Stairs.
So then I do know what they're saying is that, yeah, it's in signaling is crucial.
Yeah. Excellent. So I think this is a good time to pause. And, you know, a good introduction for individuals to the gut microbiome and bone health. And we'll take this up again in part 2. Thank you, Ken.
You're welcome.